And I'll let you handle audio levels and everything so I can just concentrate on what we're talking about.
It's like the Outer Limits. I control the horizontal. I control the vertical.
It's all right.
It's all me.
I got
Radio Now. No, I'm starting the show now. You got to shut up.
Oh, you're starting the show? I have to be quiet? Okay.
Yes, you got to shut up.
Okay, I'll shut up.
Ham Radio Now, episode 152. We're going to call this one Friday Night BS. BS stands for bull session. I don't know what you were thinking, but Friday night bull session. Haven't done one of these before, and I've been wanting to for a long time. And on the Skype line here, I have my old buddy, Bill Pasternak, WA6ITF. Say hello to everybody there, Bill.
Hello, everybody there, Bill.
He follows instructions very well. I've got my watch going here. Because we're going to try to talk for about an hour. Now, this is going to be a special episode for the people that complain that I interrupt people too much. Because in the conversations that we've had, many multi-hour long conversations not being recorded, this is my time to talk. And then it's done. I get no more opportunity. Bill is a raconteur. Probably everybody knows who you are, but we probably ought to go through some of the basics.
I'm about as basic as you can get. So.
Founder of Newsline.
Yeah.
When did that start?
We started as the Westlake Radio Network in '76, but we really got started. The first newscast per se, which was number one, was started in 1977, a repeater deregulation, if you remember back that far.
I do.
And every day the FCC was kind of, and the ARO were coming out with, yes, it's going to happen. No, it's not going to happen. Yes, it's going to happen. So Jim Hendershot, first, I am not the founder. Jim Hendershot, WA6VQP, was the founder. And I just was one of one or two assistants, people who helped him out. And Jim decided to do a one-time newscast, and it was going to be about repeater deregulation. And the day it happened, he called around, got some interviews, put the thing together on open reel tape, made a copy of it on a cassette, gave it to Wayne. I can't remember the guy's called Wayne. I can't remember. Anyway, gave it to him. Wayne took it up on the motorcycle on top of a hill on 223.5 with a cassette player and a Midland 13509.
I remember those well.
I still have one in the closet, I think. Wayne was on his motorcycle and with a whip antenna and a 13509 and a battery and played that first newscast, number one, probably to a half dozen to a dozen hams and a lot of jackrabbits.
Do you still have the tape?
Yes, I do. I have number one. I have every tape that has ever been done, and number one you can find on the on our website, www.arnewsline.org. I put that up there. Bob Sudock and WB6FDF had suggested, why don't you put some of the early ones up? So you'll find a couple of the early ones up there on the news on the website.
Newsline.org. You can see that I've been there. Okay, now
and if you look, let me see where it is. It's in Extra. Go into Extra. And if you scroll down, you'll see old newscast someplace in there.
Got a lot of extra stuff there.
Yeah, that's what we, stuff
are,
about.
Are people still using the dial-in service?
As a matter of fact, I got a call early this morning. Some guy could not get through, and I know it's up there because I put it up there. Let's And there's number one, September 27th, 1977. And you can actually, if you hit the listen button on it, you can actually hear Jim Hendershot come up and he'll talk about it being the Westlink amateur radio news.
The following is a QST. This is Westlink. Good evening. I'm Jim Hendershot in Los Angeles, and this is the Westlink amateur radio news. The FCC dropped a deregulation bombshell last week. Bob Thorne?
It's a lot of memory. When you think that 1977 to the present, how many years is that? It's over 36 years.
And your claim to fame is that you have not missed one.
Ever. Yeah, as I told you yesterday, I was in a couple of years, well, 20 years ago, I was in the hospital with kidney stones.
I've had those. And, they're fun.
Yeah. And I'm in Cedar Sinai, and I'm there with a pad and paper, literally writing the script on Demerol. So, and you know what that's like. So I don't think we have to go. But we got to that. We've never missed one. And
so when did you take over?
Number 72, Jim, I think 72 was Jim's last one. And that's when he announced that he was engaged, getting married, moving away. And he was going to close it down. And he said, do you want to take it over? And I said, I didn't have time. I was working. At that time, I was still, what was I working for? 76, 77. No, 77, I was just out of my own. I just started my consulting business. And so
yeah, really you don't talk about what you have done for a living very much. I don't think very many people know what your background really is.
Well, let me just finish this and I'll tell you that.
That's my famous interruption.
Anyway, yes, I'm good at that too, so you better watch out. Jim was going away, so I wouldn't want to take it on myself. So the late Bill Orenstein, KH6 IAF at the time, he became KH6QX, said, look, I'll do the technical work if you do the writing. So that's how it started. And then very soon after that, the late Alan Call, W6RCL, who's one of the, as you know, is a Dayton winner, started helping, because I didn't know how to write news. I'd written columns for 15 years by then for 73, but I had never written a newscast, you know. And so Alan taught me how. And he was, I always say, Alan's call was the penultimate wordsmith of our time, especially dealing with news. He wound up as the bureau chief in Amman, Jordan for NBC News.
That was his job, was writing news, yeah. Producing news.
Yeah, he also wrote three of the ham radio films and videos. He wrote with Roy Neal, he wrote Amateur Radio's Newest Frontier, and he also co-produced it. And then Amateur Radio Today with Dave Bell and myself, and ARO Goes to Washington. He wrote all three of those.
I got a feeling if we go into that history,
we're not going to get anything else done.
Up with a 4-hour show.
We'll do that. We'll schedule another show to talk just about the movie.
Well, that's why I'm calling it the Friday Night BS.
Yeah.
Which I'm
going to take 1 minute or less. I have never done this, but I have to thank you for your help when we did the DIY Magic of Amateur Radio. I called you up and I said, what are you doing this weekend? You weren't sure. I said, well, can you grab a camera and go to this make a fair? And you got some great video, which is, you know, is in the show. So
yeah.
On behalf of all of us who worked on that show, thank you very much.
You're welcome. It was a good show.
Yeah, I think it worked out nicely.
And speaking of writing news or not knowing how to write news,
right.
Tell people what you've done for a living.
Well, I started out in, I'll go all the way back and I'll do it fast. I started in Brooklyn as a wannabe TV mechanic, became one. Was very happy doing it. I was very happy just being a guy who fixes TV sets. I don't know
TV
why.
TV
repairman. That's what I was. You know,
in a little shop, you know, down on Main Street.
Actually, I worked for different local places. Then I went to work for General Electric. And while I was working at General Electric, they decided that they felt I had more potential. So I wound up, being writing training manuals and things like that. And then you may have to edit this a little bit, you know.
Sorry, no, never. We do not edit Ham Radio Now.
We do not. No post.
No.
I told you about my shirt that says on the front. Don't worry, we'll fix it in post. And on the other side, it says, you better worry, this is post.
Yes.
Nobody knows what we're talking about, do they?
Only the TV and radio and production people.
Well, that's what I was.
And that's what I'm trying to get you to. Let's just skip forward to what you've done for like the past 30 years.
Okay. But let's say I came to California. I had a job offer at one of the networks. I showed up, and the job was gone. So that was in 1972. And I'm, you know, I spent everything. I sold my ham gear and a lot of just to come out here, my wife and myself to come out here. And so I wound up working for Sears Roebuck for 5 years doing television repairs. And during that time, Dave Bell, W6AQ, asked me for input on a film, 16mm, called Moving Up to Amateur Radio, and got me back interested in the media. I'm not going to go into where I worked in the media in New York, okay? And one thing led to another, and I eventually wound up working for what was at the time Metro Media Television, and that's now the Fox Network. And I spent 30 years with KTTV, which was the local station, most of it as the one of the technical people involved with the news department. Did some stuff on the air.
Let me see if I can reach through the monitor and pull a little bit more current information out. You repaired videotape machines.
Yeah, I was.
You were a VTR repair guy.
I go back to the old days of 2-inch quads, if you remember those.
Yeah. And the reason why that's important to me is I've spent my career as a video editor using videotape machines. And
so I
depending
was on
the folks that could fix them, because I was an expert at breaking them.
I was an expert at fixing them. Intersync alignment on a 2000. I remember those days.
Yes.
Anyway, so I spent my first 5 or 6 years there. I was basically just doing videotape, mostly 3/4 inch for the field cameras, because in those days we didn't have the single unit camcorders. They were separate VCR, mostly Sony BVU-110s, BVU-50s, and Ikigami cameras or RCA cameras. And so I knew videotape. It was something I'd always been interested in. And so I'm not going to claim to be an expert. There are a lot of people who know a lot more than me, but I had the knack of being able to walk into any videotape recorder and make it work.
It
is a knack. Was just a knack. I don't know why.
See, I could break them. Let me show you something here.
Okay. Oh, yes. I wrote a lot of that, spent a lot of time with them from April 7th. Yeah,
April 1979.
I have
a reason for looking at this one. I have a reason for even having this one. Here's Wayne's editorial.
Yep.
On the next page, how did you rate being in the next thing in the magazine after the editorial?
I think it was longevity. I stayed there a lot longer than a lot of people did.
So in 79, you were doing this column called Looking West. And,
Looking West.
In 79, you'd already been doing this for a long time?
Had started in 70. I came out in 72, so it would be early 73, mid-73, probably April 73. Wayne had asked me to do a favor for him. It's the early days of FM. He says, you have a transceiver. I say, yeah, I have a... I think it was a Midland or something like that. No, I'm sorry. It was a Regency HR2, if you really want to go back. And he says, well, write an article on what people you talk to and what, you know. So I had 3494, the old frequency, 3494-1676, and 52 Simplex and 94. That was all the thing you had in the radio. But in those days,
I go back. The first repeater that I used was 3476.
Yes. Well, that was what it was before they standardized to 9.4 with the 600 kilohertz split. The Texas
The folks in Chicago used 9.4 for simplex.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, same thing in New York City where I come from.
So what I'm wondering is, look at all this. This whole page.
Mm-hmm.
That whole page.
Yeah.
Where does it go? On to 28. What I'm wondering, and I'm going someplace with this, but before I get there, what I'm wondering is, Newsline lasts how long?
Program is a little under a half hour, unless there's something major and we will run over. But we'll warn people at the head end that we're going over.
So somehow you manage week in and week out to get something precisely to time by slashing and crashing, slicing and dicing, and getting things to the length they need to be. And yet you've had all those pages, all these pages. And here's what I was actually getting to. Does this ring a bell?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I remember when you came out here.
That's my old call sign.
Yes, WA9 NSO. And I think it was Joe Schrader who actually introduced us, late Joe Schrader, W9JUV. I think that's what got me in touch with you originally. And we were putting together this this little seminar session on repeater coordination. I didn't think you were going to come out, and I called you and didn't know you from Adam. And you said, sure. And we had a great time.
I have almost no memory of that activity. What it was an ARL convention of some kind.
Yeah, the ARL Southwest Division
convention. In San Diego. Mm-hmm. Here's what I remember of it. I was president of the Chicago FM Club. I was 29 right. years old. I was way too young to be doing something like that.
I was
that.
Only like 3 or 4 years older than you. So,
yeah.
You
know. And I was also, as president of the radio club, I was chairman of the Hamfest that they had started. Did you know Art Householder, K9TRG?
I knew Art very well. I bought some surplus stuff from him over the years.
Art was sort of a mentor for me, and he was pushing for us to get our Hamfest to be like, do you remember Serac?
Yes, Serac, I went to the last 8 of them, I think.
The Sahara Amateur Radio Operators Convention. It was in the the Sahara Hotel in Las Vegas. Art dragged me out to that. People would not recognize that as a ham fest because it did not have a flea market.
No.
There were some manufacturers exhibits, I think.
Yeah, manufacturers exhibits a lot. It was very FM oriented, if you remember.
It probably was. I don't remember it very well. My biggest problem is I have a snapshot memory. I don't have a real in-depth memory. So you're remembering these things better than me. In any case, Art was trying to get us to do a ham fest in Chicago like Serac. He wanted to bring it into a hotel. And we ended up in a county fairgrounds like most ham fests are.
Yeah.
In any case, our ham fest was the week after the convention in San Diego. And my job was to at this point for going to San Diego was to talk to some of the manufacturers into coming to our Hamfest the week later. I didn't know that was a stupid thing to do. Mm-hmm. And one of the big manufacturers, I don't remember which one, said, well, there's no way we can get our equipment there. So I went to the loading dock and I talked to the freight company that was carrying a lot of stuff back and forth. And I said, if these guys put their booth on one of your trucks, can you deliver it to this fairgrounds outside Chicago by next Saturday? And they said, oh, sure, no problem. Those guys came to the Hamfest and sat in their empty booth for the whole weekend. That's the first thing I remember about that San Diego convention. The other thing that I remember is that Santa Ana winds were blowing and it was about 105 degrees.
Yeah, that was normal. That's normal for summer here.
I don't remember meeting you. Clearly I did because it's right here in the magazine. Right.
I was hosting the session, so you had to meet me.
I know I did. I have no memory of any of that stuff. The Hamfest thing was evidently traumatic enough that imprinted itself a little bit, but it was a very snapshot memory. And what we were talking about was, and what you wrote up, was that I was the boy genius who came up with the solution to coordinating repeaters.
And a great deal you did, yes.
What you don't know is that Illinois never implemented that plan.
Oh, okay.
The thing that you wrote up.
Everybody went around with the Texas plan eventually.
Yeah. That's what happened. The thing that you wrote up was what was happening back then is repeaters were becoming very popular by the late 70s. This was, I think the convention was in, it would have been in the fall of 1978. This made the May issue of April 1979, but the activity we're talking about was 1978.
Right.
And repeaters were very popular, and the band plan as we had it, we've been subdividing it and pushing things around as much as we could, but major metropolitan areas like Chicago and Los Angeles were running out of frequencies.
By 74, we were out of frequencies around here.
Yep, and Chicago was a few years behind, and I ended up being the frequency coordinator for Northern Illinois. It was by default. The guy who was doing it didn't want to do it anymore. No one else wanted to pick it up, and I was a power-hungry kid, so I took on that task.
You didn't take a step backwards when everybody else did.
Yeah, yes, I forgot to do that. Never volunteer. So I'm thinking, people keep asking me for coordinate me a repeater pair. And I'm going, there are none. There's nothing to give you. I came up with the idea, tell you what, you go find a pair and show me that you can operate on it interference-free or at least minimal, and I'll coordinate it. I came up with that idea, but it never really worked in Illinois. But I presented that to you and to the folks at that meeting, and you said, wow, that's great. And
it was a wonderful idea, and it should have been implemented nationwide, yeah. As far as I'm concerned. It would have solved a lot of problems.
Probably would have worked as well as anything else did. Yeah. So they're still doing the deal where, please, coordinator, give me a frequency. And the coordinator goes, ain't got none. They're all gone.
Well, now you got another problem. We're getting off topic. But with all the digital stuff coming in, all the people who already have analog repeaters now want pairs for digital repeaters as well. Not converting their analog, but rather we want another frequency.
Another one.
Where are you going to put them? Just you and I know there's just it's a spectrum is finite. You just can't do it anymore.
A subject for the second Friday night BS program.
Yes, or the third.
Or the fourth and the fifth.
I think we're going to be doing a couple of these from now on.
I think we probably will. So what I want to talk about now is this thing here. Breaking news, bulletin, breaking news. And now we go to the Newsline anchor desk. Here's Bill Pasternak with the latest.
Well, yeah. You want to know?
Wait a minute. You wanted to read your disclaimer.
Oh yes. The opinions expressed by this individual you see here on camera are his own and do not necessarily represent those of Amish Radio Newsline or anybody else alive. Does that work for you?
Any description and play-by-play of the following program without the expressed written consent.
You and I are showing our media, right now. No, this is me. I'm talking for myself, not for the newscast, not for the group. This is, Gary and I thought this thing up, or Gary thought it up. We decided this is going to be just two friends talking. And my opinion is that as far as the testing end of it, it was long needed. I mean,
well, I think it's all minor
stuff. It's all minor if you think about it.
It is. But I think we need to explain what happened, because people should have listened to this in Newsline. Mm-hmm. People should have read it on the web. But you know how news dissemination is. It's hit and miss. Yeah. And it never hurts to talk about something more than once. Okay. So what's here from the ARL website is the FCC has released a report and order, and it covers three things, basically. It covers VE testing.
Right.
License.
Extension.
Yeah. Getting a credit for a license that you had and has expired for a long, long time, more than the 2-year grace period.
As long as you're still breathing.
Yeah. And then official recognition in the rules of the DMR Moto Turbo mode,
which they
sort of accidentally discovered that, technically you weren't supposed to be running that mode years after people have been running it for a long time.
And the other thing is the remote access, testing, which I think is probably the most important thing.
Last part, I've lumped that under the VE thing. So in the VE thing, it's... That you can, they can do the remote testing.
Right.
And what else was in there?
Maintaining 3 VEs.
Yeah, still 3. Processing. Yeah, they this was last winter when the notice of inquiry went out.
Which was generated by the FCC itself, by the way.
Yeah, well, but based on things that they've been accumulating for a long, long time. So one of the proposals was knock it down to 2 VEs.
Right.
Because in urban areas and suburban and even decent-sized rural areas, not too hard to get 3 VEs together.
I apologize. My glasses are riding.
So, but in very rural areas, it can be hard to put 3 VEs together. So
a lot of it had to do with Alaska.
And
Guam and those places.
Yep. So the FCC declined to change from the 3 VE deal because you can get 2 people to possibly collude on things. I don't know why anyone would want to cheat to get a ham license. It's not that big a deal. It's not that hard.
It makes no sense. I mean, over the years, there have been, as you know, there's been cases, we've reported on them, where VEs have been disqualified and this and that. And they've actually found people. And I say to myself, why would anybody do that when it's not, when if these days, with the way the tests are, anybody with a little bit of knowledge can sit down. The questions are all public. The answers are all public. If you have a good memory, and most people have, average people have a decent memory, they're going to pass the test. So, I mean, and that, it never has, it's always boggled my mind when I've done stories about people accused of cheating or VEs that have been disqualified. Why? Does it make any sense to you, Gary?
No, and it's, but then you see people cheat to win contests, mm-hmm. cheat to get certificates, cheat to get, you know, DXCC or worked all states, things like that. I do not understand. You hang that on the wall and you look at it and you say, I didn't deserve it.
Mm-hmm.
Who looks at it and admires you for it and makes you feel good? It doesn't make any sense.
No, it doesn't. I was always brought up, my upbringing is that if you don't earn it yourself, it's not worth a penny.
Yep.
And I suspect you feel the same way about things.
Yes. Let's see. What is Skype trying to tell me? Our connection is too slow. I'm seeing
a good
picture
go
from you.
Anyway. Yeah. We'll go
with it
anyway.
You might be seeing a fuzzy picture from me, but I'm still seeing a good picture from you.
No, you're fine now. You were fuzzed for a couple of seconds. That's Skype, and for what we're paying for it, we can't complain.
That is true. Actually, I'm paying for it. I pay for the $65 a year premium version or whatever that is.
Okay, so you can do multiple video conferences.
Yeah, but everybody can do that now. They've turned that over to everybody.
Yeah,
and I don't use it very much. So you still need three VEs, but what has mitigated that is the thing that they approved, which is to allow remote VE sessions. Now, that's going to be interesting.
Teleconferencing is the way it's probably going to wind up being done, I suspect.
Yeah.
Or Skype like this, like we're doing right now.
Yep. But they said you can do a remote VE session and you figure out how to do it. Yeah. We're not going to tell you. We're not going to set the parameters. The only parameter they're setting is that you're responsible for the integrity of the session. Just as you would be if you're there in person.
If you think about things, we're in a mode of deregulation in Washington in every aspect of it. And I didn't even expect if they had approved this, and we weren't sure if we were going to approve it or not, that they would want to go in any further, say, okay, do it, keep the integrity of the exams, make sure that the exams are foolproof and that they're cheat-proof, and you figure out how to do it. And I think it puts the responsibility at the right point. I mean, how can the FCC in its rules dictate how you can do it when we're dependent upon technology, and technology is always changing? Think about that.
Yeah. And I mean, they would have been chasing their tail to try to come up with that. But on the other hand, they have enshrined,
yes,
as we'll see from the Moto Turbo part, they have enshrined a lot of things into the rules that should never have been enshrined into the rules. So I can see you're in the middle of a VE session. You're using Skype.
Mm-hmm.
I suppose, you know, you got the people setting up a camera wide enough. My mind is figuring out the ways you can cheat.
Yeah, I know. I've been going through the same thing.
You got somebody behind the camera that's got the flashcards giving you the answers to the test.
I anything can happen.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, there's nothing that's 100% secure in life anymore. I mean, especially in, you know, if you go on to any of the social networks, you know that everything in your life that you post there will be in cyberspace forever. So.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's just a matter of keeping diligence. And I kind of doubt you're going to have very much cheating, especially in rural type exams, simply because those people who are really in those situations have probably studied pretty hard. They probably worked their tailbone off to get their license, and all they're looking for is a test, and this is a means to accomplish that.
Yeah. Well, and, I think the bottom line is that the benefits of doing this outweigh the disadvantages.
Yeah. I like the idea. When I first read about it, I said, you know, this makes sense. It makes sense. And also, I mean, can you imagine? Let's just use Alaska because that's the example. If you have somebody in one of these small villages, in the middle of nowhere, and there's no hams there, how do you get a session done for one guy in that town who wants to get his ham license?
Well, first the VEs drive across the bridge that goes to nowhere.
Right.
Story from the last election cycle, the bridge to nowhere? Okay.
The bridge to nowhere. I agree with the keeping three V's. I'm sorry. That's just something I can't comment on things. I take myself out of the loop. I report on it. And because I'm reporting on it, I think my responsibility is to stay out of the argument.
Well, that's a problem because there aren't very many people who know as much as you do. And I can see journalistic objectivity. Obviously, on this program, objectivity is out the window. I don't try to be an objective journalist.
No, here I'm being myself and giving you my own opinions. You know?
Sure. Well, maybe just the value of the information that you can bring, even if you don't want to try to weigh it one way or the other. But you can throw in information about what has worked in terms of three VEs and what you think might not in terms of two. What I see is the issue is in the middle of the session, the Skype goes down. The VEs.
How
do you maintain control when your signal has gone away?
My feeling on that, and I think the NCVEC will come up with all the guidelines, National Coordination of Volunteer Examination Coordinators. But my feeling was if Skype goes out or whatever method of remote goes out, you have to abandon that session. I don't see any other way.
Yeah. I mean there's always telephone, which means you can communicate with people, and that's not likely to go out. And I can see doing things like, well, we don't have a VE there, but you probably got some other hams. And so bring some proctors as trustworthy as you can get who can act as the eyes and ears of the VE in that location.
Well, as I said before, I don't think you're going to see very much abuse of this. Unless it's, if it were me, if I was sitting on the FCC, I would have limited it to extreme rural areas.
They didn't limit it geographically at all. It didn't put any rules about where this has to be, right?
No, you could do it in a big city if you had a reason. I mean, I can't see any reason to do it in a big city, other than maybe for people who are handicapped and get to a session. But, I suspect that I think the NCVEC is going to set basic guidelines. They've been very active. They've been very, very good at all this. So I think we should set back and see what they come up with.
Yep. Maybe I can dig somebody up from there and talk to them on Ham Radio Now at some point. So
I think we'll make a good interview, by the way.
Yeah. There are so many things that are possible. When I started the show, there was one thing I was going to say about starting the show. It's all your fault. I don't know if you remember this, but somewhere around 2003 at Dayton, I was thinking about doing these things. I would wake up in the middle of the night with fever dreams of doing something media related as the equipment was becoming more affordable.
Right.
And I talked to two people whose opinion I valued greatly, who had been actually doing as much as had ever been done in ham radio before. One was Rich Moseson, because CQ had done their series, and the other was you, because you were involved in what I call the Hollywood Mafia.
I guess we were at the time.
Doing most of the productions that ever got done. And I was thinking, well, we're arriving at the level where, at the time anyway, I could afford to buy some pretty decent video equipment and editing equipment and make some programs. And I talked to you about doing it and you said, yes, you said, go do this. So it's all.
Yeah. If it's my fault. I'm glad it's my fault.
Here's a good chat. It's all his fault.
Yeah. So you can see all my old collector's radios in the background.
Yeah.
The old Clegg on the right. Yeah. in a TS-520. Actually, right in back of me is a modern radio, but you can't see it. Yeah.
Let's see. There's a Clegg 99er.
There's a 22 or below it.
Yeah.
And then you can see there's the FTH-47, which is the real good radio.
They're a real ham. My stuff is all turned off right now. We've got thunderstorms going by, so antennas are unplugged, and the radios are all turned off.
Yeah, we don't get very many thunderstorms out here. We get our earthquakes.
Potentially a little bit more damage if you get an earthquake.
So the philosophy here is if you have an earthquake at 12 midnight, by the morning they've cleared the rubble, and by the next afternoon they're already rebuilding.
Yes, if you're not sitting in the middle of the rubble.
Yes. Well, that's true. I mean, that's just the philosophy of Southern California, I think. You know, let's get it rebuilt so we can go on with our life. And that kind of attitude was something I was not prepared for.
But, interesting. If you're going to live out there, I guess you have to assume some awareness that is going to happen. And and you're overdue for the big one. So hopefully that won't happen while we're on the air here.
Oh, if it does, you'll have an exclusive.
That's true.
Ham radio exclusive.
Well, Skype will last for about a second and a half into it.
Oh, okay.
So the other thing in this report and order, or at least part two, was licenses. One of the things that was brought up during the notice of inquiry was there have been some versions of ham licenses that your license has expired, or at least credit for an examination was long expired, but you still got credit for it.
Right.
They were doing that with some of the technician license exams that back when, I think it was back when it was the same as the general class.
Right, when the test was the same.
Yeah, as the general class written exam, and the only difference was a 5-word-a-minute code CW. Test for the for the tech, and 13 for the general. And once the code test went to 5 words a minute and then went away, well, the techs had all passed what all the generals had passed at that point.
And so actually much harder tests than they were at that time.
So why don't they get an upgrade? And the FCC said, okay. You got it.
Yeah.
So now we're saying, well, so if you passed this stuff at some point in the past, why can't you get credit for having done it? And people said, well, you know, if you're licensed, you keep your skills up and you know what's going on. And that is just flat not true.
A lot of people get their licenses, buy a radio, and that's the end of it. You know,
they're not builders.
They're not into keeping up with the state of the art. And how many people build equipment?
Well, buildings, and to me, that's got nothing to do with it, because I've built a power supply and never got finished in a couple of Heath kits. So that's got really nothing to do with it. But you could be an active ham for 10 years and then go inactive for 20 years and forget to renew.
Well, that's almost the story of kids today in ham radio. They get their licenses young. They get into their teens. They get involved with cars and girlfriends and things like that. And they drop out. And then eventually they get married and have a family. And then they're empty nesters. And, you know, they're in their 50s or so. And they say, wow, what am I going to do? Oh, I have that old ham radio up in the attic. And a lot of them come back that way.
And the only difference between somebody who's been inactive and remember to renew their license for a while, once every 5 years and then every 10 years, and somebody who didn't let it lapse was that remembering once every five or 10 years.
What do they say about the memory as you get older?
I don't want to know about that.
Okay.
So the FCC was finally somewhat persuaded, and I think that they arrived at a rare stroke of genius for the FCC and what to do about that. Which you will
I
now
thought it
explain.
Was wonderful. I thought, you want to get back. If you have a license and you can provide proof that you held that license, that it was yours, even if it's 20, 30 years ago, it doesn't matter. If you can provide proof, all you got to do is take the written element for the technician class exam, and your license will be reinstated. Not your call sign, but your license will be reinstated.
I guess if you want the call sign, you got to go through the vanity.
Yeah.
If it's available, you got it.
If it's available, you know, there's a lot of call signs that have been
So it doesn't matter if you're going for general or extra.
Right.
All you have to take is the tech.
Take the tech written test, because there's no CW anymore. Take the tech written test, pass it, And you will be relicensed. If you held an extra, you'll be an extra. If you held a general, you'll be whatever license class you had.
Yeah.
You will be reassigned that license class, which is, it makes sense.
That's the genius part about it. You have to do something. It's not hard, but you have to do something besides just say, I want it back. And you get back to where you were. Which is,
I don't know who came up with that idea at the FCC, but it was absolutely to me.
Yeah.
When I read the RNO report and order, I said, that's genius.
Yeah.
That is, it weighs one thing against the other perfectly.
And I don't want to complain about the guys who work at the commission, but you don't see that kind of clever thinking very often.
Especially in other services.
Well, I never see what's going on in other services.
Yeah.
So, this is not a proposal. This is the rule, and it'll take effect in 30 days after it appears in the Federal Register. Is that still just printed, or is it finally online?
I believe it's online. I'd have to go look
officially.
I think the we could find out. Google it.
I always say to my wife, when somebody asks a question at dinner, how could we possibly, if only there were this global repository of information and some convenient appliance for us to be able to access that. I suppose we could look it up. In any case, it gets published. We're about 45, 60 days out from those being the rules. And the
closer to 30, I would suspect.
Well, it's 30 close days after it's published, so it's got to be published first. So the other thing was the DMR/Moto Turbo thing, and that was practically just a typographical error to put stuff in there.
Yeah, that's basically what it is. The when they came up with the basic rules on digital, they didn't think that things would change. You know, the people who write the ham radio rules. So now that it's changed, hams are getting interested in using modes that were used in the commercial service. So what they've done is basically said, oh, okay, you can use it. And it's basically that simple. Okay, you can use it. I don't see, they go into a heavy language, but when you come down to it, and I think you're going to see the same thing with approval of other digital modes very soon.
Yeah. Do you understand this FXD, FXE, F7E stuff? Does that make any sense to you?
Yeah, I have a chart someplace around here that explains it, but it basically is just different, the modes. It's just, the different forms of transmission.
I decided I wanted to try to learn that stuff because it was gibberish to me. So I went into the rules and looked at the emissions and the rules and stuff, and it points you to things that are outside the ham rules if you want to figure them out.
Well, this stuff is all outside the ham rules.
Yeah, and I never could understand it. It seemed inconsistent and undecipherable gibberish. So
again, what you said earlier about being the guy who broke the machines and the guy who fixes the machines, it's a different kind of knowledge we have to have.
Okay.
I'm
an appliance operator. So anyway, you guys, Moto Turbo guys, DMR guy, I get yelled at if I call it Moto Turbo from the folks that don't operate Motorola equipment. But the Motorola folks are happy to call it Moto Turbo. In any case, you're legal. Yay. You've been legal for a while because you got a little exemption, temporary waiver. So looking at the clock on the wall, we are at approximately the 50-minute point. And
we have a whole bunch of other stuff to cover.
we're not going to get through all of it, but I do want to get to the this public service thing because that is also pretty new.
Yeah,
and it is raising a bunch of hackles out there in the community. And this is not FCC. This is the ARRL. I've got the guy to explain it to us.
Now, at Dayton, we met up with KI1U, Michael Corey. Michael is the Emergency Preparedness Manager for the American Radio Relay League. He says the ARRL has tightened up the terms, and we're no longer going to be considered an emergency service. In fact, we really aren't. The 911, 911 call centers are an emergency service. Emergency alert system is the emergency service. AM/FM TV, that's the emergency service, but ham radio is not. We are a public service, says Michael Corey. So for those of you with the patch that says amateur radio emergency service, gone. Those of you that have the ARES card, you better redo that card because it's gone as well. Your patch, that's gone. Your stickers, those are gone. No more amateur radio emergency service signs, please. In fact, I've got mine up here that we took off the car. I put some tape over it so it wouldn't dare say emergency service. Same thing with the one down there off my wagon. It's got a big thing over there. Even though the FCC rules and regulations indicate that the value of amateur radio to the public is in respect to emergency communications, that wants to be changed, says the ARRL, by tightening up their terms. Luckily, some of the other served agencies, emergency communications, I guess that's okay. This one, that's probably okay. And the San Bernardino group, that's going to be okay. But the ARES is going to undergo some verbal changes. And I don't know about you, but I hate not having that word emergency. It sort of sets us apart from some of the other radio services. So work with your ARRL rep and let them know how you feel. But right now, we're considered public service, no longer an emergency communications service. Sorry for the bad news.
Okay, Gordo. Well, I agree with you. It's kind of silly, and I'm not sure why they did that, but let's all write our ARRL reps and let them know what's going on. And if you're going up to the 100, let's scream real loud about it, because it's kind of silly. Yeah.
And
ARRL
is like government in that respect.
You got it.
Ooh, the ARRL is like government. Now, if you can see the date at the very bottom there, that's May 22nd. That is the Wednesday right after Dayton. So this was very fresh. Have you ever seen Gordon that worked up about anything?
No, I haven't. I've known Gordon since the day I came to California, and that's 40 years now. So, and I have to agree with the Gordon. I mean, but I have another reason on this, and we've talked about this. Very simple. A lot of people nowadays, especially, are getting into ham radio because they want to serve. Since 9/11, the whole concept of ham radio emergency communication has changed. And if you take away from those people who want to serve the initiative, that drive, hey, I want to be there in an emergency, they're going to walk away and they're going to go some other group, and you're not going to have an emergency, amateur radio emergency service. You're not going to have people, the concept would be, well, if I'm a public servant, why am I not paid for it? Why should I go and volunteer for to communicate for this when there are companies that'll do it that get paid for it? I think you're going to see. I think the ARL is making a big mistake because I hate to use the word ego gratification, but I think this is a part of it. People who do things want to be recognized for their potential as much as what they do. Yes, we do a lot of public service work. I used to. When I was in New York, I used to do a lot of parades, 6 meter AM, that's how far back that goes, and a lot of things like that. But we were also emergency trained. We trained for the emergency. My take on this is very simple. The FCC is the one who writes, I don't want to use the rules, but writes the guidelines in this case, not the ARRL. And the ARRL, in my view, is wrong, period.
The Gordon went a couple of steps beyond what the ARRL is actually proposing. For one thing, the ARES stays ARES. It's still the Amateur Radio Emergency Service.
At this moment, but we're not sure it's going to stay there.
Okay. I've got no information to indicate to me that it's not, but sounds like you might have heard something, at least some valid speculation.
Well, there's rumors. You know what they say about rumors? They change momentarily, so.
Yes.
But as you mentioned, there's a lot of discontent on the especially on the internet, which is where we both look. And a lot of people are very mad over this, and I think the ARRL is going to lose if they make this move. Just a personal, my personal opinion.
Well, they've done it. I mean, it's a done deal. They always go backwards, but it's a done deal. Mike appeared, Gordon met Mike at a ham fest the next week in the Virginia City, Nevada. And he got more on board with this. The Ham Nation 2 weeks later, he was more more party line.
The ARES service is going to stay the same, no change, just the umbrella name of public service. And I believe that Michael heard from many folks indicating that think about the folks down at the bottom of the ham radio chain that are right in the public service field that are handling emergency comms. And his comment was, our service to the public includes all amateurs, not just a select few set apart by an acronym.
Now, I was hoping that Mike Corey would be able to be on a program this week, and he's not available. But I'll try to get with him sometime next week.
I think he's down in Plano, isn't he?
I don't know. Don't know. I'll try to find out what's really behind this, because this did not just appear. I mean, it did appear.
QST was announced.
You know that it didn't just appear a couple of days before the column was.
No, written. Because there's at least 2 months production time on the magazine. So
yeah. So and I'm sure that this had been a discussion at the league board of directors for a long time. So there's something behind it, and we'll find out what when I get a chance to talk to Mike. But it in theory is just a label change, a nomenclature change, with nothing actually changing in practice. It's just what they're calling what's going on.
Yeah, but will the public accept it? Will the ham radio public accept it? And from what I'm seeing and reading, and you, I think you are too, is that the ham radio public is not going to accept it.
No, the only people that seem, nobody's happy with it that I have to talk to. The only people that are even accepting it are the folks in the wonkier positions. In appointments or league officials. So, but this is the kind of thing if it's going to work at all, it's going to take a while.
And so. I may be wrong, but I have this gut feeling, you know, the newsman's gut feeling that in the end, the Arrow's going to lose on this because very simple, as I said earlier, there's a certain amount of ego satisfaction that comes with this.
Yeah, so you think they'll walk it back?
I don't know if they'll walk it back, but if they don't walk it back, I think they're going to have a lot of people just walk away.
Get one of those lose membership things over it.
You know,
I hate to see that happen, but
me too, because they need as many men right now, especially with what's happening in Washington, and you know, our spectrum from especially anything above 440s in jeopardy. The worst thing you could have is a major loss of membership. But the other side of it is the ARL since 9/11 has been pushing very, very hard on emergency communications and stuff like that. So how do you tell all these people who you've gotten into the hobby, and they've done a very good job of it, how do you tell them, well, the reason you came in is not the reason you're here anymore? I think people will become very disillusioned. I mean,
do you think that the league has a substantial membership among the MCOM interested
people?
Yes,
I do, because who is the one organization that is training ham radio operators as emergency communicators? I mean, they're doing a very good job of that. And I am pretty sure that anybody that they train is becoming a league member. I mean, why would you go to the league if you're not going to become a league member?
I don't have any numbers to back it up. But
I'm just giving you supposition on my part.
But I mean, whenever you talk about the core league membership, mm-hmm. and what drives their decision-making about a lot of things, it's a bunch of old fuddy-duddy HF, DX, or contest, or CW operators. And
even that's changing, because if you look at the complement of the board now, it's changed. You have a lot of younger people on the board now.
Okay. I'm not in touch with that at all. Yeah. I've got a question that is very much related, though. And I'll be interested to see your position on this, or your awareness of it from way out there in California. And that is this AUXCOM thing that is starting to build up. Are you even familiar with this AUXCOM thing coming out of DHS and FEMA?
No, I'm not. I've heard of it, but I haven't done any studying on it. So
yeah,
I would be the wrong person to go to on that right now. It's on my bucket list to look into.
So you've heard the term.
Yeah.
But it's kind of hard to tell what it is. And I'm very familiar with it.
They've really explained it, you know, to any great degree. It's another one of these concepts that come up. Yeah.
Yeah, I got some websites I can show you. The U.S. Yep. Oxcom Society, that's actually something. One of the reasons why I'm as familiar with it as I am, and I'm not as familiar with it as I want to be, is that it originated among, or at least, maybe not originated, but the folks here in North Carolina were very much involved in getting it started. Okay. And I don't know if this is a fair thing to say or not, but it is. But something that I've heard, it's maybe a little bit more than rumor category, and that is that FEMA was not happy with the league dragging their heels on getting HAM certified for the FEMA courses.
I have not heard that. I have to be honest. Yeah. It hasn't reached the West Coast yet. It's probably stuck on the Mississippi River or something.
Well, you're familiar with the FEMA courses for communicators,
yes.
The 100,
yes.
200, 700, 800. And the story that I've heard, and I don't know if I can get anybody to admit it, even if it's true, and it may not be true, is that FEMA administrators were not real happy that the league was not adopting that as part of their emergency communications training. And I don't know whether the league is or not. That's one of the things I wanted to talk to Mike Corey about. So
yeah, he'd be the person. He'd know. He's on the inside on that. Yeah. So,
but you don't see those things in QST and the public service columns in the website.
I also get the MCOM newsletter that the league puts out, and I don't see anything on that in there either. So,
yep. So let me look at a couple other websites here. This is some courses you were talking about. Who has courses available?
Right.
And this is a bunch of courses. Although I don't know, I get the impression, at least from when I took the 100, 200, 700, 800. Mm-hmm. It was all administrative stuff. There was no hands-on stuff. Although some of the other courses I'm told, which I haven't taken yet, do a little bit more hands-on. Here's South Carolina Oxcom. It doesn't exist everywhere yet, but a bunch of states have been picking it up. There's some more Oxcom courses. So you can see that this stuff exists out there. Here from the Homeland
DHS.
Security. Well, one of the things that I was doing was trying to find out where Oxcom lives within DHS, and that turned out to be something that was pretty hard to find. It doesn't have a leadership structure. It doesn't have someone in charge of Oxcom. It's just sort of there.
Exists.
Yeah,
it exists.
And I can tell you about. Maybe not the structure, but about the concept. And the concept is that several groups have provided auxiliary communications to emergency management. And under the ICS structure, HAMs are one, Civil Air Patrol, MARS, right. National Guard. National Guard doesn't seem like it would be quite volunteer, but I think they're kind of lumped in there.
Mm-hmm.
And they're all sort of being lumped together under this Oxcom thing and then given this training so that they can fit into the incident command structure better. So that's the idea.
It hasn't hit out here. If it has, I haven't heard about it.
Yeah.
But, we do have out here a very, very active, I want to go and call it CB, but non-amateur radio unstructured, groups that are involved with FRS and things like that.
Search.
Nothing with cert type groups, but nothing I've been able to find out. There was I guess it was like 4 years ago. There was a major push to get a 11 meter CB cert type operation going. I don't think it went anywhere. I haven't heard of anything about it in 4 years,
it's a rough part of the spectrum to try to do anything serious.
Well, people want, again, it comes back to people wanting to do something, especially, the times we live in. And, you need a central, I think you'll agree, you need a central core organization to organize all this. And in ham radio, we only have the league. There's nobody else. I mean, who else? I mean, think about it. So we're dependent on the ARL. And in most things, they do a very good job. But, you know, no organization is perfect. Absolutely not. Sometimes, you know, look, we both work for major corporations, and we both know that even major corporations can make big mistakes.
Sort of like especially major corporations.
Right.
Well, the impression I was getting was that although Aries is a part of Oxcom and a welcome part, that Oxcom was sort of an end run around the ARL's hold, not quite a stranglehold, but their leadership position in emergency communications is part of amateur radio. It was sort of FEMA saying, we're kind of tired of waiting for the league to get this act together, and we are going to bring in the Aries people, run them through our training, and then they become communicators for us. So
I think you'd have to interview someone like Rugatti who's involved with DHS, and you really have to go to the top on that.
And as you know in the news business, if this is controversial and there's someone who wants to paint a little bit glossier a picture of it, no one's going to admit to it.
Of course not. But the whole thing is how you go about and finding out before you're going to go into a heavy interview, you have to have the facts in front of you.
If you can get them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You have to at least be aware of the subject matter to the point where you can speak from. That's why, again, this is a subject I've heard of it. I haven't, it's not out here. As far as I know, there's nobody involved in it out here yet. If it comes out here, you know, I'll find. Yeah. But it's not very big yet.
Well, that's illuminating on its own, that that it is something that here in the Southeast, North, South Carolina, Tennessee, I think it's getting to be bigger in Colorado, but a handful of states, it's becoming a thing. But out there, someone in your position of finger on the pulse type of stuff.
If it's happening here, I'd know about it.
Yeah. Well, if it's happening anyplace big, you'd probably know more about it.
I've heard of it, but as I say, it's been, I use the word isolated. Is that a good term? You know, just to certain areas.
It's limited, at least.
Yeah, limited. Yeah. I don't know where it's going to go. I really don't. I don't know if it's, I'm the first to admit, if I don't know anything, I'll sit down and research it, you know.
I suspect if the league had embraced the ICS training and incorporated that deeply and become more of a really responsive partner with FEMA, that none of this would have happened.
I have to say your guess is as good as mine.
Well, yeah, that's all it is. It's a guess. So, we will continue to ask the questions.
As I said before, and I will, I'm the first to criticize the league if they do something wrong. I'm the first to praise them if they did something right. I mean, it's that simple. Who else is there? Who else is there in amateur radio in that kind of position of leadership? We've had a lot of attempts going back to this. This may precede you, but you remember the Institute of Amateur Radio? Wayne Green. 1961, he decided he was going to have his own ARL and formed the Institute of Amateur Radio, IOR. So that's how long the challenges, at least I know. I was licensed in 59. So that was the first challenge to the ARL I ever heard of. And has any of them ever succeeded? No.
No. Nope.
Why? Why?
Well, we're too small.
Well, even if we were moneyed, if we had the background, you've got an organization 100 years old. They're entrenched.
Yeah,
and by and large, they do a good job. I mean, no organization is perfect, but who else we got?
Yeah, but I think that amateur radio as a group is too small for more than one big dog.
Well, they had that in Canada many years ago, remember?
But within their realm of emergency communications, clearly FEMA is, with Oxcom, is is looking to do something they don't think they're getting from the league. And within that limited realm, important realm, but limited realm, they'll probably succeed.
Well, it'll be interesting to watch, because if it's going to happen, it's going to happen. You know, if it's going to go national, if it's going to get to anything substantial, it'll happen within the next 12 months.
You weren't able to make it to Dayton. There was an Oxcom forum, was one of the lead-off forums on Friday at Dayton, and one of the few forums I was able to attend.
That'll be interesting, because as I said, out here, I have not heard anything about it. As I say, you know, a lot of CERT organizations, a lot of that are non-amateur radio-oriented, but... I won't say it's a new one because I've heard about it, but it's not something that the West Coast so far is, or the Mountain States for that matter, seems to be involved in. And whether it's a challenge by the FEMA to the ARL, I don't know. Because, you know, if you think about this, Gary, FEMA is the government. It doesn't have to challenge anybody. It doesn't. It can just do what it wants.
Well, challenge may be not a really good way to describe it. It's just FEMA saying this is what we're going to do. One of the things that I hear all the time from the folks that are involved in this is, and they're talking to hams and they're talking to everybody else who's coming in to do this, and that is you leave your badge at the door. We appreciate your organization, but when you walk in here, you work for us. You don't work for them. Mm-hmm. And that's been said with a certain amount of hubris, which initially rubbed me the wrong way.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, but that's government. That's government. Think about it. Yeah. It's government.
I understand what they're getting at. I understand what they want. They don't want you working for two masters. They want to be the master. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. when they say it with an air of nose-in-the-air authority, then I go, yeah, well, maybe I don't want to play.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know.
And there are a lot of people who say, okay, that's fine with me. You know, it comes down to the individual. It really does come down to the individual and the individual's feelings. That's why I said before, you know, the ARL, if they push this concept of no more emergency communications and you're now doing public service only, you're going to have people walk out because they joined to be emergency communicators. And I think that's the... You know, that's in their core. That's in their mind. And yes, you know, maybe they don't even realize they're only doing public service. But to their thought patterns, to the, you know, people who have spent this time to become, quote, emergency communicators, they're not going to walk away from, they're not going to want to walk away from that, even though it's just a name change. I think it's going to be a problem for them.
Yeah. And that leads me to the last thing I want to say about that, which is, and this is just something that's in the back of my mind, and I've got absolutely nothing to back this up, is that the Oxcom thing, appropriating the emergency side, maybe the league is thinking, let's diminish the word emergency and focus on something else. And let Oxcom be Oxcom, and the league will do a broader... umbrella of public service.
And
the way to start that is to change the label.
Yeah, who knows? I mean,
I certainly don't. Like I say, that is pure, rampant, wild speculation. As I've told many people here locally, if you look in the very small print on the back of your license, it says you are licensed to speculate wildly on the basis of no information.
Yeah.
You probably haven't seen that on your license. Go look on the back.
Yes, maybe on a version on the internet, but not on the back of my license. Right. Just wrapping this up, you know, as I said earlier, I think if anything's going to come out on this with the league, it'll probably come out at the centennial. I wouldn't be too surprised I'm not going to be there because I have family problems here, so I can't get away. But it'll be very interesting to see what comes out politically, and this is a political thing more than anything else. What comes out of it at the centennial?
It's a good point. That certainly their opportunity to go into this in much greater depth in a forum that they are very much in charge of. So,
yeah, that's under the, you have the controlled circumstance. So
yeah,
but that'll be interesting to hear, see, what have you.
Yeah, I don't expect to be there either. I just can't afford to go. So
yeah, well, yeah, I have my wife is ill, so I can't leave, and so I'm stuck here with the most wonderful person in the world, who's my whole life. So, yeah.
But you will have fingers in that pie. You'll have people.
We got a couple.
You'll have
people
eyes and ears looking.
Go. There are a couple people on Newsline who are going to be there. So,
and when it's all done, you and I will BS about it some more.
Yeah, I'm curious about this, and you know, from a personal standpoint, I just think they're making a mistake, and that's, you know, what more can I say? I think it's just a gut level feeling that if they push this, the people who they brought in because of emergency communications, I'm going to take it personally. I really do. I really think it's going to happen that way. But I may be wrong. I'm not a soothsayer. There's a word we haven't used in a long time.
And maybe it's just us media types ginning up controversy. Who knows?
No, I don't think we're ginning. I think we're looking at things very clearly, if you want to use, you know, at least my philosophy is I'm an observer. I don't get involved in the fight. I watch the fight, you know. I've always loved to watch situations, watch people, and watch reaction. And that's probably the news person in me that was cultivated when I was in my 30s, I guess. But, you know, before that, I was just a mechanic fixing stuff.
Yep. And I'm trying to carve out a little bit different niche, and that is definitely the pundit end of things with my own opinions, but trying to get other people to talk about what they know. And I'm trying to make this very brief because there's one other thing I want to cover, which will be a little bit happier talk.
Much happier talk.
Yeah, but that is that from my point of view, if I try to bring in people who know what's going on, often they don't want to say what's going on. Whether they run a company or the ARL or some other serious organization, if there's something that is other than just, you know, bunnies are cute and fuzzy, they don't want to talk.
Yes.
So you go talk to the people who are willing to talk, and those are journalists. And that's not just here. That's everywhere. That's on CNN.
Oh, yeah.
That's
yeah.
on Twit. That's on any of the major news shows. You can't get a straight answer out of the people that are the principles in something very often.
What I love to watch is, by the way, talking about observing, is you watch a news show, Sunday morning news show, a politician will be asked a direct answer and they'll answer a totally different question.
Yeah. Well, I asked Rich Moseson if CQ was unable, but he didn't answer a different question. I asked him if they weren't able to pay their printing bill. And he knew I was going to ask that, and he didn't answer the question. I mean, he answered a more generic question, that things had been difficult. So we were going to talk about CQ, but we'll have to save that for another time. The last thing I want to hit is this this Eris and Cerex thing, because you've done my two-part public, not public service announcement, my news release.
That's something very near and dear to my heart. It really is. I've told you this, you know.
Yep. Well, I had sent you some copy based on the research that I had done that said that the first Cerex operation was in 1990. And you said, no, it wasn't. It was in 1985.
Right. It was.
And you knew, when apparently no one else did, where the term Cerex came from.
Yeah.
You made it up.
I didn't make it up. I was sitting there when it seems to have been made up. Because we were, let me just give the story real quick. I wish I could. I was trying to get a hold of Frosty Oden because he could verify this. We were editing a show about Tony England's flight, and the script didn't have a name on it. There was no name. It was just a show, and Roy had written it, and Roy Neal at K60UE, and it was just called, I think it was W0ORE flight was named. I have a copy of around in this mess someplace. I know.
Yeah, this was the second amateur radio in space on the space shuttle.
First one was Owen Garriott, and then in 85, Tony England flew, and his claim to fame was that he was the first to operate slow-scan television from orbit. And we did a show on it called the Shuttle Amateur Radio Experiment, okay? And as far as I know, the first time I ever heard the concept of SAR-X, now, there may have been an earlier one, as I said to you, but first time I ever heard the term SAR-X used was Roy and Frosty were sitting there coming up with a name for the show, and I'm sitting in the back taking notes. And this is in the edit room at CBS Television City. I don't remember if Roy or Frosty went and said, well, this is an experiment. And they went bantering back and forth, and, well, it's a shuttle amateur radio experiment. And that's, as far as I know, that's the first time I ever, and this is 1985 when we edited the show, and as far as I know, there was not a Sarex name before then. So whether there was or not, I can't, but that's the first time I ever heard the term, and that's when I heard two people bantering together, and was, again, putting together a TV show, and if you remember the old days, it was a lot of work to edit the TV show.
Yeah.
And so we spent quite a few days putting that thing together. And that's, as far as I know, that's where the name Sarex came from. And it wasn't in 1990. It wasn't in 1992. It was in 1985, based on Tony England's flight.
Yeah. Well, it certainly wasn't in 1992. And one of the videos that's in my four-part Eris to the Max series, right, episode 144, is a 1992 contact, which turned out to be the sixth one, the series of where they're talking to students. And Tony England's, his second one, things had been put together to the point where he was talking to student groups.
Right.
So that was part of it. I've got the history of this stuff is not very consistent out there on the web, because I was telling you 1990 based on stuff that I read on the ARRL website. However, once you told me, no, it went back earlier than that.
Yeah, it went back to 51.
Here's the May 1985 QST. And this is, again, from May. This is Dave Sumner's editorial talking about Tony England. Let me put the whole picture up there.
Yeah, if you can.
Yeah. Plans are moving forward for him to operate 2 meters using that window-mounted antenna that Owen used. And right. At this point, he already knew the focus will be making contacts with youth groups through amateur
Tony
radio
wanted
clubs.
That, if I remember correctly.
So that's what they were planning on doing.
And yeah, but did you notice there's no name Sarex in there, is there?
Not there, but then in the November 1985, the report of what happened, there it is.
Yeah.
And they don't say where they got the name, but this was the first reference that I could get to it. It's in the subheadline. Mm-hmm. It's in the first, don't say Sarex, but say Space Shuttle Amateur Radio Experiment.
Well, Paul Corson, who wrote that article, was part of the team, so to speak, working on, I think, both the first and second films, Amateur Radio's News Frontier and Sarek. So he probably, I wouldn't be too surprised if even Paul was the one who may have helped coin this thing, but he wasn't in the edit room with us, I can tell you that.
In any case, nobody is written it down and put it anywhere that I could find easily.
No, the first time, as I said, the first time I ever heard the term was when Roy, Frosty, and I were sitting at CBS Television City in Hollywood, probably about 1 o'clock in the morning, I think it was Frosty. Well, what's the name of this? Something just off the hand, and we're tired already. We'd worked all day and then go to CBS at night to edit.
Well, if there had been a name, if Sarex had been a name that was going around, even in those early days, then you would have taken that right away.
Yeah.
But it sounds like you guys came up with it spontaneously.
Well, we needed a name for the show.
Yeah.
Or they needed a name for the show. I was an associate producer on that, so I was sitting in the back. I'd take notes, and someone would say, what's such and such? Oh, go to time code 14, 15, 19, whatever,
And go get me some coffee, black, please.
Actually, we had that in the other way. This is CBS. They were, clum de la clum.
Yeah.
It was a beautiful setup they had there. I loved that place.
All right. What this is perhaps illustrative of is that as history is being made, sometimes it doesn't get documented very well. You don't realize what's going to be important.
Obviously,
Don't realize what's going to be important. I didn't realize in 1992 that I was making a serious television program on something that had not existed that long. Is the video that you guys made, is that available anyplace?
Yeah.
Is it on the web anywhere?
I haven't seen amateur radio. Amateur radio's newest frontier is up on the web. You can find that. It's both on the ARRL website and also on YouTube. I haven't seen Sarex, but I have the original master. Actually, I have the 1-inch master out in my garage, but I have it on beta and beta cam. So if anybody would desperately need a copy, I could probably make a DVD for them. But that's one I've got to get put up. I'm going to have to get the hold of Sean at ARL headquarters and suggest that he put that one up, because that's about the only one of the shows that done for the league that has not been put up on either YouTube or on the league's website.
This is sad looking.
Oh, yeah, somebody put that. There's a lot of stuff that was not put up by the league. It looks terrible. Old VA. And that one, I know which one that is. That's out of, the guy put it up in the wrong aspect ratio also, because that was not 16:9.
Yeah, so there's a there's another version of it. Let's see.
Yeah, there's a version on the ARL's website, if I remember.
All those shows in their best form should be on YouTube now. It's disappointing that they're not.
Yeah, and what I'm going to do is I think I'm just going to start posting. I have a YouTube account. And
By the way, Dave Bell made a good accounting of himself at Dayton at the town hall, since you weren't able to get out there.
Yeah, he took over for me. I had my wife's health is not good, and I had to pull out, and so Dave was gracious enough to pull.
And Don Wilbanks.
Yeah, Don is one of the greatest people in the world.
They played some very interesting stuff from early days. So the town hall was mostly playing videos.
That was
some that Bill and your group made, and some that they just found out there on YouTube that featured ham radio back to the 30s.
On the 1939 piece from that was a great piece. I have that. I captured that. That's how we found it. I captured that, and I actually have it on the DVD, the whole program here.
Do you remember what the name of that was?
Oh, God. I think it was just called Amateur Radio or Ham Radio or something like that. Right. Radio Hams. That was the name of it. Here it is. Here's the DVD I captured, and it's called Radio Hams. It was done in 1939.
I'll get to watch a commercial here for a moment. Okay, now
yes, let's go watch a ham.
No, that isn't it. No, yeah, it is.
Yeah, that's the one, except that's another version of it. There are about 10 versions of it up there. I took the highest resolution one I could find.
Massive and expensive equipment marks the professional radio station. But in the amateur field, radio parts often include pieces of assorted junk ingeniously assembled by operators who are called hams.
I wish I could announce like that guy does. He's really good.
Cards to prove the Niall Forbush voice, the radio voice,
exchanged by the hams and proudly displayed.
Yeah, so you can go see that yourself. It is.
Yeah, it's a great little piece.
And, yeah, it's a lot of fun.
That was we used to. I actually put the show together, so that was the session, and then I had to pull out. So Don and Dave took over, and Don. And they did I've been told they did a wonderful job. And
they did. You know, it was fun to watch.
I am very lucky and very fortunate to have some wonderful friends out there too.
Yep.
I don't know what I'd do without, especially right now. So.
Yeah. But, yep. I understand. Well, tell you what, I think we have used up, we have lots more to go. So there'll be plenty more of these shows. If anybody cares to watch them.
I suspect we're going
to
be doing a couple more of these.
Whoops, you're falling off the edge of the earth there. Lean to your left a little bit.
Sorry about that. I'm covering up the TS-520. That's
even worse.
Bad.
Yeah. I had to work hard to get things aligned properly so that the radio shows up behind my microphone.
Mine is just by accident, I'll tell you.
All right, so let's wrap this up, and we'll try doing this again in a few Fridays from now. My goal someday is, first of all, to get it live if we have a schedule, if it's going to be on Friday, and to get using either my multiple Skype capability or Google Hangouts where a bunch of people can come together.
Yeah, and get a whole bunch of us together. Yeah.
And then we'll go like 7 hours because –
if you got to make it an even 12, man, got to make it a half a day. You've got to go 12 hours.
Yeah.
And we'll get food catered in, of course.
Yes. Yeah. And around the world.
Have Arvin collect for the food so that we'll all be able to have catered food.
Well, and thank you for mentioning it. Arvin is sitting back there.
He's been very nice. He's been very quiet.
He's the chief financial officer of Amateur Radio Video News.
And, that's right.
His only concern is the money. He doesn't care about the programming. He is, on the other hand, getting a little upset at all the publicity that Maximilian, the pig on Geico, is getting.
Oh, yeah.
Because they're friends. They've known each other for a long time. And Arvin sits there behind me and doesn't get any airtime. And Max on the Geico commercials is becoming a big star. So
yeah, he's taking probably the place of the lizard.
Yeah, Arvin is getting his little piggy nose a little bit out of joint. But he would remind you to stop by hamradionow.tv if you enjoy the program. And by this time, there's nobody watching. Click Arvin's icon, and you can make a contribution to keep us going. Why would anyone want to keep us going?
I don't know. Maybe they enjoy us. Maybe they don't.
Have you ever made it to the end of one of my shows?
Oh, yeah.
Then you know how this closes. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
73.
No. You can say who you are.
Oh, okay. We'll do it the other way. So take two.
Take two. Oh, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm Bill Pasternak, WA6ITF.
You can add the reporting from the Newsline headquarters in Los Angeles,
not
California.
Really.
Oh, and then I say over.
And out.
And we're done.
Sounds a little good to me. I would say check tails on the tape. Boy, am I dating myself.